Yeah, that's a suitably nihilistic opening to this lecture. So, if you're watching this in the right order, if you're watching these videos in the right order, you should be at the moment preparing for an exam next week on referencing. So this is going to be my super duper quick run through the APA referencing system. Now, before I begin, here's a couple of things. I have been telling my colleagues for years now to change their module handbooks to reflect that we use the APA system. If they've got in their module handbooks that we use in the Harvard system, they are wrong. We are not using the Harvard system. I'm right. I'm right about everything. I know everything. I'm superior to everyone, and I have no sort of God complex, of course, but you know, this is just the way things are. I will. Please, if anyone's doing that, please tell me and I will shout at them. I will hunt them down and get them to change it. We use the APA system. Now, in practice, for what you do and your undergraduate degree, and indeed if you went on to do a postgraduate degree, there's virtually no difference between the two systems anyway. So do not worry about it too much. But it's just, it bugs me. It really grinds my gears. We use APA. So, there are a lot of different referencing styles out there. You are going to use the APA system. The APA system is used throughout the humanities subjects. It's very easy to learn, it's very simple to use. And here's my first tip. You start using it as soon as you read something. As soon as you read anything, write a reference for it in the APA style. Record all the details, and this enables you to reference something accurately later. So get in the habit, whenever you read something, of just writing out what that thing is in the APA style. Why do you reference? This is the thing, right? So one of the biggest differences between what you've done previous to doing your degree and what you're doing now is that you are required to reference in your work. The reason why you do it is really, really harsh, actually, but I'm going to tell you it anyway. It's literally that word at the end of this slide, credibility. You have, as an undergraduate student, zero credibility whatsoever. Okay? I'm sorry about that. It sounds really, really harsh to say, but I don't care what your opinion is on something. I genuinely don't. At this point in your studies, you don't have the expertise or knowledge to claim expert opinion on something. Therefore, you must investigate what has been done in a subject area in order to demonstrate knowledge and experience. And that is where you reference the work of other people who are experts in that area in your argument that you are making. So you demonstrate that you've researched appropriate literature. You acknowledge the use of ideas and of other people. You avoid plagiarism. Plagiarism, hugely important. It's absolutely key to good academic practice is accurate referencing. It enhances how your work looks. It shows writing based on knowledge and enables the person reading your work to trace the source and give credit for effort and quality. And I'll go back to one word here, plagiarism. Plagiarism is serious. Plagiarism, as you may or may not know, is the, for want of a better word, theft of other people's work and passing it off on your own. If you are caught plagiarizing, you will be thrown out of university. It's that simple. Do not go past go, and do not get your £9,000 back either. And not referencing accurately is not an excuse if you have plagiarized. If you have used other people's work and not referenced it, and it was an error, is that I didn't know how to reference, or I didn't know how to do it. Tough. This is why we get you to read the referencing guide this early in your course, and this is why we can force you to learn that referencing guide, okay? So you don't fall into this trap. Don't do it. Don't do it. It's not worth it. It really isn't worth it. And plus, of course, splish splash, your opinion is trash. You have no credibility. Referencing gives your arguments credibility by referencing work of others. So, what do you need to reference? Any source of information you use in your essay. So, my friends, if you use my lecture notes, you damn well better reference them. Oh yeah, I'm serious. And you, you can use the stuff in it that's been referenced by all means, and so on and so forth. But anything you use, any textbook, any book, any website, but I don't encourage you to use websites, but if you use one, you better damn well reference it, etc., etc. Any source of information you must reference. Now, the way I sort of structure this is this. You'll all be doing media history with me after Christmas, right? So you might be outlining the history of a particular medium, like the printing press, for example. You say, printing press was invented by Johannes Gutenberg in 1450. Now, I'll ask myself this question. Did you know that before doing this course? The answer for 99% will be no. Therefore, that needs a reference. You didn't know that. That's not knowledge that was innate to you. It wasn't given to you at birth. So you need to reference that. That's what I mean when you reference all sources for information. We reference via citations. A citation is an acknowledgement of other people's work in your work, which refers to them using or refers to a direct quotation you've used by them. So, citations. This is the format of doing citations. There is no other format to be used. There is nothing else to be used. An author's name followed by the date of publication. E.g. Gabe 2011. So if you want to reference my 2018 book on virtual reality, you'd say Evans 2018. It's so, so difficult, right? I mean, it's such hard work. It's incredibly hard. Evans 2018, Gabe 2011. Now, if you're using a quotation, you give the page number within the citation, e.g. Gabe 2011, page 75, states that health inequalities, blah, 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 whatever he says, right? If you're referencing from my book, Evans 2018, colon, and the page number, if you're quoting from it. It's so hard. I mean, yeah. How difficult is it? If you got a long quote, and we don't encourage a huge number of long quotes in essays, but using the odd long quote is absolutely acceptable. It's not a problem. But any quote that's over two lines, what you should do is just indent the quote, right? Indent it one indentation from the left and have it. So it almost appears like a little indented paragraph of its own. But the actual citation itself, the format remains exactly the same. Okay. Really hard so far, right? So if they're two authors, you cite both of them. Oh my God, we're making it so difficult. If there are more than two authors, though, you don't even have to cite all of them. You can cite et al. Williams et al. 2012. I'm still talking here about the citations you use in the text of your essays themselves. Quotations from journals follow exactly the same format. There's no difference between books and journals here. There is some things where you will be citing something that is citing in something else. So you haven't read directly that work. You've read it maybe in a textbook or something like that. So you would have, in this example, Denny 2005 cited in Moore 2008. Now, the importance there is in the bibliography, you just reference Moore 2008 because you haven't read the other thing, right? That's absolutely fine. That's perfect academic practice. In the bibliography, you will only ever list things that you've actually read. Okay, so you might actually, especially in first and second year essays, you might use this citation method, somebody 2005 cited in somebody 2008. You might use that format quite a lot. Now for essays, please divide the bibliography into texts and websites. Do not split your bibliography up into journals and books. Journals and books go in the same bibliography entry under text. Really, academic essays should not be contingent on websites at all. Now, if you use ebooks or you have read a journal article online, it still goes in the text bit, doesn't go in the websites bit, okay? Sources cited in the main text have to be in the bibliography. They have to be. If you don't do that, you haven't done the bibliography correct. Publications by a single order author should come before joint publications by the same author, that should say. Don't ever use et al. In the bibliography. Use all of it. If there are two books or articles by the same author in the same year, use ABC. Titles of books and journals should be in italics. And let me tell you now, my friends, titles of books and journals should always be in italics in your essay too. Not in quotation marks, because you are not quoting the title of a book. The title of a book comes in italics. Don't ever use numbers or bullet points in a bibliography. They should be ordered in alphabetical order by surname of the author. Okay? If you're just watching this video and thinking, what the hell is this guy talking about? Have you read the guide? If you haven't read the guide, download it and read it. This all makes sense. Okay, so examples of these. Now, this is how you reference a book in your bibliography. Denny D, 2005, Risk and Society. See, title in italics, place of publication and publisher. Joint authors, Crawford and Newbern, 2003. In, you know, it's all there. Edited book, Lee and Stanko, eds. Tells me they're the editors, Researching Violence. Wow. Book, a chapter in a book. Slightly different, right? So you've got the authors of the chapter at the beginning, then you've got the title of the chapter in quotations, and then you've got the book itself following the actual normal way of doing it. For journal articles, it's slightly different, but not hugely different. You have the author, the initial, the date, the title of the article in quotations, the title of the journal in italics, then the number, the issue, and the pages. Now, my friends, I stop here and I give you some advice, okay? There is a company who later on in this module I will describe as one of the most evil companies on earth, but for want and purpose today, they have something amazing on it. If you look up journal articles or books using Google Scholar, the address for which is scholar.google.co.uk or .com, depending on which Google you use, you can cite. It will do it for you. It will generate all this stuff for you. Under every search item for a particular search term in Google Scholar, it has underneath just a little quotation mark. You hit that, pick APA, and it cites it for you, and you just copy and paste it. It's amazing. If you need any help with that, just give me a shout. But I'm even making this easy for you. Now, that won't help you with the exam next week, but you know, it's gonna help you in the future. Citing websites. I don't want you to cite websites very much, but sometimes we have to cite websites. I cite websites, it's okay. In the essay, you identify the website in brackets. This website is called Justice, so we put Justice. Do not put the website address. That's not what you do. If the article online has an author, you may use the author's name there. Do not put like a huge URL or website address though, because that's not what you do. You identify either the author, or if you can, very often you can't find an author for something online, so you just identify the website. So if it's from the BBC website, what do you put? Oh, I know, BBC. If it's from the Guardian website, it's gonna have an author to that article, so you put the article author's name there. Boom! In the bibliography, you give full details of the URL of the website, the date you accessed it, and you put those in alphabetical order as you normally do. So, an example of using a website in an essay. Young offenders may receive a range of court orders if they are convicted, from referral orders as a first court disposal through custody under a detention and training order. Justice 2012A. Because that's the page we've used. And in the bibliography, it will give an address to that page. As of October 2012, 1,595 youth offenders under 18 years old are being held in custody in the secure estate, Justice 2012B. So we're using exactly the same format, but that B indicates that when I go down to the bibliography, there will be two entries for Justice 2012, A and B, and they will have a different website address. That's how you do it. For example, you can see that there's two different website addresses. It's amazing. Oh my God. Oh my word. It's amazing. if you're using things online, so I said, you know, if you've got an ebook, for example, the format remains relatively the same, but you will give the address of where you got that ebook from. If you have a journal article or online, what journal articles usually have, if you've read it online, is something we call a DOI number. This long string of digits here, each journal article that's ever been published has been issued a DOI number. You can just put that down and tell us when it's been accessed. What is a DOI? It's a digital object identifier. It can usually be found at the start of an article. And if you use any kind of database, it will give you that. Don't worry about DOIs too much. If an essay came in and it had a journal article in it and you don't have the DOI, I don't care, to be quite honest, right? As long as I know where that was published, who wrote it, etc., that's absolutely fine. So, assessment one is coming up. What you have to do, I mean, I've just whizzed through this, right? This is so fast. This is so flippant of me. But this is a really brief overview of the APA referencing system. I'm not going to give you much more of an overview because this is about learning yourself. And me telling you and you sitting down and learning it and doing it are two completely different things. And you do have to learn referencing. You have to do it yourself. This is why I'm giving you a test next week to test that you have read the stuff. So, go away and read the referencing guide that I've put on Canvas for this, okay? You're going to need to show knowledge of it. 25 item test next week. It counts for 10% of this module. If you fail, which is if you get under 40%, remember the grading criteria, you'll be doing it again. Now, last year, first year that I ran this last year, people were getting 100, people were getting like 96, most people got over 70. Okay, it's a really, really good way of getting a first, you know, your first grade in university can be an easy first. And you're like, yeah, bitch, I've got a first in your face. Just read the guide. Don't just read it once, read it twice, read it three times. If you've got any questions about it, who should you be asking? Don't ask WhatsApp groups about things, ask me. Okay, I'm actually an expert in this sort of stuff. I do it all the time. Ask me. I'm here for you. I'm here for you people. I'm all about this, okay? Ask me the questions. I want you to get first in this. This is the one piece of work I'm never going to have to mark because the machine does it for me. I'm all about that, but I want you to get a first, okay? Summarizing. Assessment two is a summarizing task. More details. Where do you find more details about it? You find them in the module guide. So look in the module guide. Now, what I would say is once you've got assessment one out of the way, you need to start your summary of assessment two straight away. This is absolutely key and critical in academic study to be able to summarize material down into things. But we're going to talk much more about summary in week four in the seminars for week four, okay? At this point, I just want to say something very important. Obviously, this is the first assessment. It's kind of stressful and kind of anxiety provoking for you guys. Stress and anxiety is huge. Okay, it's a major, major issue. First of all, for next week, I don't want you to feel stressed out or anxious. Okay, referencing is something you're going to have to do and you're going to have to get good at. This is a chance for you to get on top of it straight away. But if you don't do well, you can take it again. Okay. It's not a problem. It's not going to be a big deal, all right? I just want you to commit some time to doing it now so at least you know what referencing is and you're getting the hang of it right now. I am not going to punish you remorselessly if you make the odd mistake in the first year. That's not how it works, all right? That's not how things should be. Stress and anxiety are major issues and I don't want to be provoking you stress and anxiety, okay? The whole thing that you're doing right now, adjusting to university, especially like in the midst of a global pandemic. None of this is easy. And the key to dealing with stress and anxiety is asking for help. Do not suffer in silence. Do not ask for help. Now, you don't actually probably know where my office is because you haven't been there, because you can't, because we're in like a whole thing and social distancing and all that sort of stuff. So for the intents and purposes of what we're doing in this module at the moment, you just email me, okay? You know where my email address is. You can find it on Canvas, right? Just email me. It's no problem. No problem at all. Campus Life Office, which is usually on the ground floor in the Keir Hardie Annex, right next to the Keir Hardie building where the Media Studies Department is based. If you ever feel things are getting on top of you, please get in touch with Campus Life. They can help, okay? Do not suffer in silence. We all suffer from stress. We all suffer from anxiety, okay? Some of us suffer really, really badly from it. As soon as you start feeling like things are getting even a little bit unmanageable, please ask for help. That's what we're here for, okay? And that means also with next week, look, I'll be honest with you, it's a multiple choice test, okay? It's easy, and you're going to be doing it remotely. So pro tip, print out the referencing guide. There is no time limit, right? So print out the referencing guide, have it next to you, look up the answers. Yeah. It shouldn't cause you any stress, but I want to see that you can actually apply the knowledge from that referencing guide. How to succeed in the next 3 years. This is just one last thing, okay? Read. The library, use it. It's not a mythical place to sleep or worse. The reason I put worse is I usually tell an anecdote now, and I'm going to tell it to you guys now, all right? So when I was an undergraduate student, I was a psychology and philosophy undergraduate student at Swansea University centuries ago. And it was in a different century. First year was. I've seen three, four different couples and, you know, whole mix of sexualities here. I've seen three or four different couples having sex in the library. So it's not just a mythical place to sleep, or worse than that. You know, I've seen people smoking drugs in the library. You know, I've seen people snorting drugs in the library too. This is all a long time ago. This really cleaned up its act, that place, yeah? But it is a place to go to get knowledge. It has all the stuff in there. What you also need to do is attend. Now, for all intents and purposes at the moment, that means watching these videos and attending our Zoom sessions. But when we go back to in-class sessions, you need to come. It is no coincidence that attendance correlates almost to a positive one ratio with achievement in a degree. Those people who attend do well. Those people who don't attend just don't do well. Do the work in plenty of time. That gives you time to proof your work and to meet with lecturers so you can discuss it. Take it seriously, because this is a full-time job. Okay, being a student's a full-time job. You are a full-time student. I mean, there's very few cases of part-time students anymore. You are full-time doing this, so take it seriously. You may well have a job outside as well, but this is your full-time job. Always ask for help when you need it. That's what we're paid to do, give you help. Take advice, feedback and criticism seriously. It is not meant to say you're my bitch or anything like that, or to give you shit or anything. Feedback is there to help you, to push you forwards. And enjoy it, because if you don't enjoy it, what are you doing it for? Do you know? It's like me with any kind of housework. I don't enjoy it, so don't do it, because it just sucks. Don't enjoy it, so don't do it. Okay guys, this is the end of this video. If you have any questions, raise them in the seminars this week. I will be concentrating on referencing in one of the seminars this week. I'm all over it. Don't panic. It's going to be fine. You'll be awesome. And next actual videos will be getting into proper media content with a discussion of Marxism and how Marxism is used in media studies. So, see you guys again. Cheers.